back to Finding Life, where we dive deeper into the Word of God to find out what God's life is for you and for me. My name is Father Joseph Gill, a priest of the Diocese of Bridgeport, Connecticut, and it's great to join you today. One of the things that I hear about our Catholic faith a lot, especially in the media, is, gosh, why does the church have so many rules? All these rules, rules, rules. And a lot of people think these rules, these moral laws, they're just meant to be killjoys. They're just meant to make our life miserable and make it tough. But my friends, I think that's one of the biggest misunderstandings that the modern world has about the church. The modern world thinks that all rules, pretty much, are bad. They hamper our freedom. Today, I'd like to take a look deeper into what are moral laws all about? Why are they obligatory? And ultimately, what's the goal of morality? I think we'll start with that. What is the goal of morality? The goal of morality is actually very simple. It's not just to be nice people. The goal of morality is to be happy. Now, that sounds kind of strange because a lot of times the world will say that the truly happy people are those who have no limits on their freedom, that can do anything they want, whenever they want, with whomever they want. But that's very contrary to the Christian understanding of happiness. Happiness, rather, is to do that which you were made for. So a bird is happiest when it's flying. A fish is happiest when it's swimming. And you and I are happiest when we're in the right relationship with God. Here's a great example I like to use. And for this, I need this lovely Shalom World jacket here. You know, if you own a jacket or something, it always comes with rules. It always comes with, like, laws. And you say, wait a second, I didn't know that when I purchased my jacket. But take a look. I look at this jacket on the tag, and it says, machine wash gentle, cycle only, use mild detergent, do not use fabric softeners, do not use bleach, do not use non-chlorine bleach, and do not dry clean. Now, wait a second. These rules seem to hamper my freedom. What happens if I disobey these rules, these laws that govern the proper use of this jacket? Well, I'm probably going to destroy it. If I start using bleach on it, the black's going to fade and it's going to be spotted. If I dry clean it, I mean, it could destroy it. It's a down jacket. All the puffy feathers could be flying out. So clearly, these laws have everything to do with how this jacket is meant to be used. And if I follow these rules, this jacket's going to serve me well for many years. If I decide to disregard these rules, then ultimately the jacket is kind of worthless and it's going to break, it's going to, you know, become unusable. That's the same way with you and I. Instead of having a tag that says don't dry clean, we have tags that say don't kill, do not commit adultery, do not lie, do not steal. These are kind of the tags for us that tell us how we best function. Now notice too, who do you think wrote those laws onto this jacket? Well, it's probably the manufacturer. Whoever made this jacket wrote them to tell us how we should best live. Same way with ourselves. Who wrote the laws that are written within human nature? Well, God did. He wrote those laws upon our hearts, and we call that natural law. Now, what is natural law? This is an idea that's often thrown out there that, to be honest, a lot of the world doesn't believe anymore. Well, natural law means that we can discern moral principles from the objective, unchanging reality of human nature. Now, I know that was super philosophical, so let me kind of break that down for a second. So, natural law means that by observing ourselves, by observing what fulfills us deeply as human beings, we can take natural principles from that. Now, see, one of the challenges of that is that these principles are what we call a priori principles. In other words, they're first principles. I can't prove them necessarily. I can give evidence for them, but I can't prove them. Here's what I mean. 2 + 2 = 4 is another a priori principle. I can't prove it with a logical proof. I can give you an example. I can put two apples together and two apples together, but you can still say, well, I still think that equals 5. And I would say, well, no, you're wrong. I mean, count them. They're 4. And you're like, yeah, well, you're counting wrong. Well, I can't give you a demonstrable proof to show that that's really 2 + 2 = 4. That's something you just have to accept. You either see it or you don't. That's a lot like natural law. You either perceive it or you don't perceive it. You choose not to perceive it. Now, the challenge with natural law is that it's not immediately evident to us. It's something that we really have to sit there and reflect on. We have to think, okay, what is it that really does fulfill the human person? Is, you know, sleeping around with a multitude of women, does that really fulfill the human person? Or does purity fulfill the human person? And since we live in a fallen world, sometimes we get confused about that. In fact, one of the effects of original sin on the human person was a darkening of the intellects, our intellect. Ignorance suddenly came into the world because of original sin. In fact, listen to the words of St. Paul, who talks about natural law in Romans chapter 1. He writes, "So they are without excuse." He's talking about pagans who have never heard the gospel. They never heard the Jewish law. They're pagans, if you know, have no concept of the gospel. But he says, "They, the pagans, are without excuse. For although they knew God, but did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their senseless minds were darkened." In other words, they could clearly perceive that God exists. They could look around in creation. They could look within themselves at natural law and see that God was real, but they chose to ignore it. He goes on to say, "Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man or birds or animals or reptiles." In other words, instead of worshiping God who is spirit, they started making these false idols and worshiping birds and worshiping, you know, Jupiter and Saturn and all these other false gods. "Therefore, God gave them up to the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a base mind and improper conduct." In other words, because they had closed their minds off to the reality of God, as God has revealed himself through nature and through the human person, they suddenly found themselves, you know, with all of their desires perverted. And now it became darkened. It was hard for them to understand what is truly good. He goes on to say, "They were filled with all manner of wickedness, evil, covetousness, and malice, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malignity. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's decree that those who do such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but approve those who practice them." So in other words, even pagans, even people without the benefit of faith, know that these things lead to death. They can clearly perceive that immorality and that slander and gossip and hatred, that they lead to death. They don't need the light of revelation to tell them that, but they choose to do it anyway because their intellect is darkened and their will is weakened. They're no longer able to easily choose the good. Now it becomes an effort, becomes a struggle. So because natural law is sometimes really tough to understand, that's why God gave us divine law. In other words, the Ten Commandments. He gave us the Ten Commandments to show us what we should be clearly perceiving, but because of original sin, we find it a struggle to understand. So God's revealing himself to us for our happiness. He's showing us what leads to deep, authentic human fulfillment by giving us these Ten Commandments. But now let's break down that definition of natural law even further, because it is discernible principles that come from objective human nature. What do I mean by that, objective human nature? Well, does human nature ever change? No, it doesn't. It doesn't, which is something that our modern world kind of doesn't really understand. Recently, in my office at Trinity High School, I was having a conversation with a freshman who was pontificating about all things under the sun, and he was saying, "You know, I think the church needs to update its teachings about marriage. We should accept married couples who are homosexual. We should accept all kinds of married couples. You know, if you want to be in a three-person marriage, that's okay too." And I asked him, "Well, you know, this teaching not only is the church's teaching, but it's been pretty much every culture in history has recognized that marriage is a man and a woman. Do you think human nature has changed?" And he said, "Yeah, I do, and I think the church needs to change with it." And I said, "Well, that's kind of the end of our conversation, because if you think human nature's changed, I really can't go further in talking about natural law. Because human nature is unchanging. The same things that fulfill us in 2017 also fulfilled us in the 1200s and in 30 BC. We are always fulfilled by love. We're fulfilled by friendship. We're fulfilled by virtue. We're fulfilled by knowing God. We're fulfilled by, you know, having our physical needs met and our emotional needs met. These are ways in which we do experience true fulfillment. And it's the same throughout history because human nature never changes. It's objective." Now, what does objective mean? Well, there's a difference in philosophy between objective and subjective. What I mean is this. Objective means that the truth is out there. It exists in reality. Subjective means that the truth exists in myself. In other words, it's dependent upon my experience to experience the truth. Let me give you an example that might make that clear. Let's say, for example, that you're in a sauna, and the sauna is 120 degrees. It's nice and toasty warm. You're sweating up a storm in there. It's great. And someone else is in a swimming pool, a very cold swimming pool that's, you know, 50 degrees or something. Now, the person gets out of the swimming pool, and you get out of the sauna, and you both enter the same room. It's probably 75 degrees in that room. What are you going to feel? Well, you're going to feel that the room is cold because you just came from 120 degrees. This other person's going to feel that the room is really warm because they just came from a swimming pool that's 50 degrees. But so that's your subjective experience. I can subjectively say, man, this room's really hot, or this room's really cold. Objectively, though, the room is 75 degrees. That's a fact that's out there in reality. It's not something that's dependent upon my own experience. That's something that we can know simply by measuring, simply by looking at it. Now, is morality subjective or objective? It's objective. In other words, what really fulfills a person is not based upon your own opinions or my own opinions. It's based upon what is in reality. Let me give you an example. Let's say that there's a fish who really wants to walk on land. And so that, you know, maybe in fish speak, they ask a pelican to kind of take them out of the sea and put them on the beach. Well, objectively, the fish may feel good about that because his desire has been fulfilled. But do you think that that fish is really going to be deeply happy? No, the fish is going to die because without water, the fish doesn't survive. That's the same way with morality. Morality is objective because it's based upon what fulfills us as human persons. That's not something that really is up for interpretation. But again, the struggle is, because of original sin, it's not always clearly perceived. And a lot of people may say, well, I personally believe this, but I personally believe that. That's called relativism. Relativism means the belief that morality is subjective. And that's something that I encounter all the time in my ministry, and I'm sure you do as well. People saying, well, I'm personally opposed to abortion, but you know, I don't want to force my morality on someone else. Or I personally think that such and such is wrong, but I wouldn't want to force my morality on someone else. But now, wait a second. We don't do that in any other realm of human activity. Do parents say to their children, you know, I personally believe that broccoli is really good for you, but if you think the chocolate cake is better, go ahead, by all means, eat chocolate cake. No, parents would never say that. Parents are saying, no, wait a second. Objectively speaking, this is healthy for you. We know that because it's got vitamins and minerals, and people that eat it live a longer and happier and healthier life and grow taller and stronger. So therefore, you should eat your salad. You should eat your vegetables and not have candy for every single meal, because there's an objective truth there. And that's true not only on the physical realm, but also on the spiritual realm. There's an objective reality to morality. We can say this action really fulfills a human person. This action really makes them happy. So in a word, what really does fulfill us? I think in a word you could say virtue. Virtue really fulfills us. Virtue makes us deeply happy. What is virtue, though? Well, virtue is something that's been talked about really since the ancient philosophers, because they recognized clearly that a virtuous life was a happy life. A virtue is a morally good habit. That's a very simple way of putting it. A virtue is a morally good habit. So it's not just any good habit, like brushing your teeth is a good habit, but it's not a virtue because it's not a morally good habit. But it's not just a morally good action either. It has to be something that's natural, something that comes to us like second nature. So for example, let's say I'm walking down the street and I see a poor man there with his little cup out in front of him and I give him a dollar. Now that's a good action. Now, if I'm naturally disposed to give him a dollar, and I'm very generous in the rest of my life as well, and I often give to family and friends who ask, and I'm always selfless, then I have the virtue of generosity. But if that was my one only generous act, and usually I'm very stingy, and I don't like to give money away, and I'm very self-centered, then that's not a virtue. That's just a good action that you do. So living the virtues means having these habits so that it's easy to become patient. It's easy to be charitable. It's easy to be self-controlled. It's easy to be pure. Now, the challenge is developing virtues because they don't come naturally to us. I think every human being has some virtues that they excel in naturally and some virtues that they have to work on in a more difficult manner. There's a great story of Saint Therese of Lisieux, one of the great saints of the 1800s, who had a lot of very natural virtues, but also had to work hard on some virtues. And there was a great story about how there was a nun in her convent who used to drive her up the wall. This nun was just annoying in every way, and she used to bang her rosary beads against the pew sitting right behind Therese, and that noise just was like fingernails down a chalkboard. And she used to just, you know, do anything possible to annoy Therese. And, you know, it wasn't intentional. It was just kind of the way she was. And Therese had to practice the virtue of kindness to such a great degree that she said sometimes she was bathed in perspiration, just sweating so hard trying to treat her kindly. Later on, after she had died and they were interviewing people who knew her, this nun that used to annoy her said, "Wow, yeah, you know, Therese and I, we were best friends. I mean, Therese always would look for opportunities to be kind to me. It must be because she really liked me." And then they read Therese's autobiography, Story of a Soul, and she writes in there, "Gosh, I couldn't stand this nun. She was driving me insane." But she had developed the practice of virtue to such a degree that she was able to practice charity easily and without much inner struggle at the end. So how do we develop a virtue? Well, there's two ways in which we can develop a virtue: practice and prayer. First, we pray for it, because really all virtues come from God's grace welling up within us and giving us the strength to overcome our natural tendencies so we can become virtuous people. The challenge, however, is that when we pray for a virtue, God is usually not going to just give us the virtue. He's rather going to give us an opportunity to practice the virtue. So let's say you pray for the virtue of patience. That's kind of a common one that a lot of people struggle with. If you pray for patience, he's not going to just dump patience on you. He's actually probably going to put you in a traffic jam so that you can practice that patience. Or he's going to put someone in your life that day who just grates on your last nerve so that you can overcome your natural tendencies and instead practice that virtue of patience. And like any other habit, it becomes easier with practice. I played baseball in college, and the first time I, you know, was learning how to play baseball as a little kid, you know, it takes a while to learn how to swing the bat. You got to put your hands back like this and turn, and at first it looks clunky and awkward. But once you start doing it over and over and over, practicing the right way to swing a bat, soon it becomes second nature, and you don't even think about where your feet are and how you're swinging your hips. In the same way, with practice, virtues become natural to us. They become second nature. And so, my friends, why did God ultimately give us his law? It's to direct us to virtue, and through virtue, we find happiness and fulfillment. My friend, his laws are not burdensome. His laws, rather, are for our deeper freedom. Whoever is in sin is a slave to sin, and God gave us his laws to lead us out of that slavery and into the freedom of the children of God. So, my friends, next time you're tempted to think, "Oh, gosh, another one of God's laws," think, "Thanks be to God, Lord, you have shown me the way to happiness."
Someone who's used media a lot in evangelization, so I believe in the importance of Catholic radio, Catholic TV, Catholics using the new media. Can I encourage everyone to watch Shalom TV? I think it's a great vehicle of evangelization. And God bless all of you.
Shalom World, God's own channel.